So let's try both of them now. So here I'm on the make.parapps.com portal, and I am on the homepage, and I'm going to create a Canvas app from blank. So I can select this option. I can give my application a name, let's say my Excel app. And I can select the format to be either I want a tablet view or a phone view. So let's go with the tablet view right now and let's hit create. So it's going to give me a canvas where I can drag and drop controls and, you know, configure various logics behind. And that way I would be able to interact with the app, show data from this Excel sheet. And if there are any operations that I want to perform in this data, I can do it all on this Canvas app here. So let's try this. I'll select this data source. Now I'll search for import from Excel. So this one is like this Excel sheet that I'm using. It's a static Excel. That is why I need to use this import from Excel data connector. But if let's say my file is on some, let's say OneDrive for business or anywhere, I can use those to connect to this Excel directly. But for now, this is a static one. So let's go with import from Excel. I can select a number of files from my file explorer here. So I have selected this details file, just the one we created here. So now as I can see, as soon as I imported this table, it gave me an error like no tables were found in the Excel file. Only table data is supported. So whenever we are using Excel as a database, the mandatory step to do is like convert all this data into a table format, and we can name this table anything. And then if we try to import it, we can do that in the application. So let's select everything here. Now go to insert and table. So it will ask like, what are the columns and everything for my table. And since I have headers in this table, I have selected this checkbox where it says my table has headers. So let's click continue. Now I can see that everything is formatted as a table. I have multiple rows in this table and all my data is in a good form, and I can use this in my Parapps Canvas app. So let's name this something as my contacts. Okay, so I have renamed this table my contacts, and if I am now going to import this in the Canvas app, I can see this my contacts table and I can import it. So let's go again here. Again, I'll search for import from Excel. I can select this details.xlsx file again. Okay, I have not saved it. That's why. One second. So I just saved it. Again, I'll do import from Excel. I selected my file and now I can see this my contacts table. So if I'll select this and connect to this data table, I can see that it is now added in my app's data source, so I can access it. Now let's see like how I can show the data from this Excel table. So here I can place a gallery control from the insert tab. I have selected gallery, and there are multiple formats we can choose. And in this case, I have selected this vertical gallery. And if I am going to put this my contacts table, my contacts. So it is going to, refer to this, all the data I have in the table, and I can individually select what fields I want to display. So here I have selected like address. Let's say I change this to something else, city. So now I can see all these fields in different controls. I can add other controls as well here in the gallery and show data like that. One other thing between like using Excel as a static one or referring it from a different data source is delegation. If you are using static Excel, you can, there is no delegation limit and you can have as many as records are there. But the limitation is you cannot write back to this data. Whatever you have imported, it's going to be the same. But if you are using OneDrive for Business or any other Excel sheet, you can perform all the CRUD operations and save data accordingly. So static Excel, in a scenario where the data is not going to change and you just want it to be discrete to the users. And dynamic one in the case where I want to change the details, I want to perform operations on this data, save it, create new, delete the ones, and all those things, then we should refer to the dynamic ones. Next, coming back to our presentation, the next portion we are going to cover is how we can connect SharePoint to our Power Apps. How can we use SharePoint as a database? So let's go back here. I have this site, demo site, and in this I have created a students list. So if I just go back here, I can see that there are like three students which I have entered the data for. Now let's come here in the application and see how we can connect to this list from the application. One other thing is like you can connect to your document libraries and to the SharePoint list and show the data here directly in the application. So let's, you know, minimize this to a little bit. And now let's search for SharePoint. Okay, I have selected this. It is going to look for the recent sites I have used. And if there like your SharePoint list is not coming into this list, you can copy the URL, the first one, so until the name of the site, and you can paste it directly here and it will recognize your SharePoint site that time. So let's select this demo site and I can select the student list that I was referring to, you know, sometime before, the one I showed you here in this different tab. So let's see, now I can see that this student list is added as my data source in the app. I can again put a gallery control or something. So if I, you know, place this and add here students, I can see the details. I can again, similarly, the same process, I can configure all the controls to show different values and everything. One other thing is like if I have attachments on any of these you know, items and I want to show them directly on the app, I can select the image control and pass the reference from attachments like this item dot attachment. Since this is like a single control, if I have just one attachment as part of the item, I can select something like this item dot attachments, and then I can pass the value of that you know, attachment so that it's displayed as an image. If it is a different kind of a control, we can have multiple you know, controls here and we can configure the visibility on the basis of that only. So that is how like you can configure multiple attachments and show data from your SharePoint sites into your Canvas app directly. Moving forward, let's talk about delegation. So what delegation is and how we can, you know, overcome it with showing data in our applications, and what are the delegable data sources. So if I were going to tell you a single line about delegation, is like it is something, a hard limit, or you can say, so we have one soft limit and a hard limit as well in delegation. So the number of records that are going to be fetched over one request is what comes under delegation. So let's say I have a SharePoint list with 5,000 records. By default, the delegation limit in the Canvas apps is set to 500, but we can change this to 2000, which is like the hard limit. And beyond that, it's not changeable. And you can only have, you know, if you are doing some filter query or something, you can have at most 2000 records returned at one request. So that is what delegation means. And if we are working with huge data, we need to make sure that we are using all the delegable functions and getting as much data as we can. If there is like a situation where you are feeling some, you are getting some errors, or you know, you're not able to get whole data based on this delegation warning, you can use collections to perform multiple you know, multiple queries to the data source and save it in the collection. So let's say in first loop, I'm getting first 1,000 records, and in the second one, I'm getting the next 1,000 records, something like that. But the, again, with this, if you're doing this, you need to be careful about the number of records you have in place. So if you're going to keep, let's say, 10,000 records at a time in a collection, so that would make your app slower. And any, I mean, if we are using Power Apps, the only thing we want is, like, not just Power Apps, if we are using any application, the speed matters. So we want to keep our app responsive. We want to keep our app, you know, moving with all the data I have and everything like that. So try to keep only that data in caching, which is, you know, going to be frequent, and you're going to, you know, rely on it and update your applications accordingly. So delegation limits, let's talk about that again. So by default, this is 500, and this can be, you know, maxed out to 2000. Apart from that, it's not, you know, increasable. And if we talk about a few delegable data sources, so common data servers, SharePoint, SQL Server, there are few which can be delegated, and a whole list of the data sources is available on Microsoft documentation. So if you are using something else from CDS, SharePoint, SQL, you can take a look and, you know, get more details about the delegation specific to your data sources. Moving forward, we have like a few functions, you know, we can consider as delegable or non-delegable. So if I'm using filter, that is like delegable. Let me tell you one thing about how delegation works. So let's say I have the delegation limit set to 500, and there are, let's say, 700 records in my list. So if I'm going to, you know, create a query or create a request to get some data, what it is going to do is it's going to look into the first 500 records only and return the result. And if, you know, you want to get, let's say, the record which has ID 601, in that case, you should be using these delegable functions only. If you are using first in, last in, all these functions, the query is not going to be delegable, and it will, you know, return you the records which satisfies the condition under the first 500 records. If you, you know, increase the limit to 2,000, then it will look for the first 2,000 records and return the data. So that is why, like, whenever you are writing your expressions, then make sure you're going through the documentations first, and, you know, checking all the available, you can say, validations and all those things related to each individual function. An example would be like the starts with function. So if we are passing, you know, a field here, and if we are passing a static data, like I want to search, and in my, let's say, my city name, it starts with A. So if I'm writing starts with and then static value A, it's delegable. But if I try to pass a variable in this function, then it becomes non-delegable. So those things we can get, like, most accurate information from the Microsoft documentation. They have documented each and every function in a very beautiful way, and you have examples and all those, you know, use cases, so that the way of understanding the functionality is a bit easier. So that's how, like, we can, you know, we can decide where to use the delegable function and non-delegable functions. Again, so let's say I have, you know, I want to get details about a lookup column. I have a column assigned to, which is looking into user's entity. So let's say I want to search on that data. So if I am going to write that query, it's going to give me a delegation warning, like you are trying to, you know, search for a lookup function. So maybe when we want to, you know, update that formula, we can use add column function. So whatever input we are passing in add column, if we are applying any filter or all those things, they are delegable. But whatever output the add columns function is returning, that's non-delegable. So each function and all these functions have different, you know, behavior, and we must make sure like we are using the accurate ones. So that's how, like, for a lookup column, if I want to search on a keyword, I can add a column which returns a static value, something like assigned to dot name, So I get the name of the assigned person, and then I can perform a search operation on that returned records. So that's like delegable and non-delegable function and how you can use them, minimize the data that is going over a connection, and you are getting the accurate results. So that's like all about the delegation and non-delegable functions. Moving forward, we have collections. So what a collection is, whenever I'm getting some data, so let's say here I have in my application, I have directly referenced it to students, my SharePoint list. And if I'm going to, perform any operation or anything that, let's say I have a search, text search, let's add it, text input here. And I want to search this text input based on my students. I'm not going to perform any updates on this gallery. It's just that it's just for viewing the data, and I can search through these records and everything. Since I have directly referenced it to students list, it is going to make that call. And so if we want to reduce the number of calls, then we can collect this data in a collection. We can store any number of records in a collection and display it on the app. So what we can do is, let's say I want to do this on app start. So I write clear collect, my collection name. I am naming this my collection for now. And I can add the students SharePoint list here. So clear collect is like whatever I have data in my collection, it will be removed, and it will populate now with the records I have in student database. If I just write collect here, so that means like I am not going to remove the existing data, but it is going to append those records to the existing data I have in the application. So we want this to be cleared when we are creating the collection. So I have written the query like clear collect, then my collection name and the data source I want to refer to. So this app on start triggers whenever we open the app, but since we are working in edit mode here, so let's say we run this on start manually. So it has made that call. Now I can go to views, collections, and I can see that my collection is populated with the data I have in the SharePoint list. So all the details, ID, modified, everything I have in the collection now, and there is no need to make calls to the SharePoint list until I have to. Let's say I want to patch some data or anything, then I can directly reference this collection to this gallery and I can view those details. In case I want to patch the results from here, I'm referring this collection here to show the details, but I have a button in case that it should update the data. What I can do is I can use the ID column, which is like the unique identifier of my SharePoint list. So with that, I can look for records and I can update it accordingly. This is also useful in a scenario where I have a gallery and I am like performing a bulk update. And so I have made changes to only first record, not the other two. So I don't want these other two records to, perform the update and change the values, because even if I'm not changing the data, the modified date and time is getting changed. So if I want to configure only for the first record, then I can simply match it on the ID and apply the conditions, like if this value is changed, I can assign a variable or match it with the previous values. Then in that way, we can apply the validations and update only the selected record or the required record. Hey, do we have any questions until this point? Okay, I'll go ahead in that case. So what are the benefits of using a collection? It stores temporary data from any of the data sources, and that data is available for the current session. So let's say I have stored this students collection here. So it is going to be saved just for this current session. If I am adding any more records to this collection, they are not going to be the same when I open the app again, or if any of the other users open the app. Until and unless I'm not making changes to the data source, they are not going to be reflected in the next session. Collection is like a temporary storage, which you can use if you have some static data or you don't want to make multiple calls to the data source again and again. That time you can use collections and show data accordingly. And this can also be used like to overcome the delegation. So just like what I was talking about before, we have a SharePoint list and it has more number of records. Then in that case, I can apply some loop and get records accordingly. So the starts with function is delegable. I can apply some logic so that I have, let's say I have a unique identifier. I can, let's say I am going to get for the records which start with A first, then B, then C, then D. In such a scenario, I can get all the records, which start with distinct keywords and use them in the application. So that's where we can use collections. And also it helps us to, reduce the number of requests we are making every time to the data sources. So the connection is not utilized and we are not, making the app slow, because in every time we are making a call, it's taking some time if the call is, performing a lot of actions at the same time. Okay, so let's move forward with a few demos. I am going to show you how you can, configure cascading dropdowns in the Canvas app. And after that, we'll look on how we can create editable galleries. Like if I don't want to use edit forms or anything, I can directly create the editable galleries and patch a bulk update on my data source. So let's go ahead and look into the demo. So I am creating a new screen here. So let's just, so we'll be doing that on the basis of this Excel sheet. So here I have related data where I can, configure on the basis of city, country, state, and all those things. So let's go ahead and see how we can configure cascading dropdowns. So in insert tab, I can select the inputs, and from here I can select the combo box. In the combo box, so there could be like multiple records where the state is same. So we only want to fetch the distinct values. So let's say here I can see I have this OH repeating here, but I don't want that to be the case in my dropdown. What I can do here is I can write an expression like distinct. Distinct is a function which can be applied to data source, and we can get a specific column distinct values. So I'll go ahead and select this my contacts data source, which we have from the Excel sheet. Then I can select which field I want this to be distinct. So in this case, let's go with the state. And so if I have applied this function like distinct my contacts, and I want to see all the distinct states that exist in my contacts table. So if I'm going to go to my app now and expand this dropdown, so it is not showing anything because the fields are not configured properly. So we can go to advanced tab. Now let's see, the display field is set to value one. That is why we are seeing the blank values, as this value one column doesn't exist. So let me change this to result, because the output of the distinct function is a single column table, and that column table's header name is result. So let's change this to result. Okay, I have changed it. Now if I go, I can see all the distinct states that are available in this data table, you can say. Also, I can enable a few properties, like I can allow searching. So here, if I do that, I can search through different states now. Okay, so it is disabling for some reason. Maybe I have not passed the form. So, okay. That Okay, so I mean, we can do that if we are using a different function other than distinct, I guess. Distinct doesn't work with the searching, but choices function and filter function, all those functions, we can allow the searching on the control. We can also allow this property where we are allowing the customer to select multiple records. So if I disable this, I cannot select more than one record at a time. So if I select, let's say, NJ now, so the previous selected result is removed. So if I, you know, again enable it and I play this app now, I can select multiple states and, you know, I can see subsequent levels on the second or third dropdown. So let's disable this for now. I have just selected one and I want to now see the city. Let's see the county first. So the county related to a specific state. So let's create another combo box here on the screen. And this second one will be related to the first one. And whatever state we have selected in this, we only want to see, this county that is comes under this state. So I am going to, write this expression as filter my contacts, my Excel table. And then I can apply a filter on the state column. So let's say state is equals to the name of the control I am using. So the combo box one, I can select this and write combo box one dot selected. So since we have only one item selected here and if we have like disabled this property, I can use selected. In case we have enabled multiple selection, we can go through the route of the selected items property. So let's go with the selected now. Selected dot result. Result is the name of column which is returned from the distinct function in the first combo box. So now I can filter those so we are going to get a county out of this item. So I have now enabled this filter for state where only the records which have state as NJ will be displayed. And I want to display county here. So let's try with the distinct function now. And out of this filter, I want all the distinct county. So if I do that, if I open this dropdown, I can see that I am now able to see four counties. And if I go back to my Excel and select the state as NJ. So if I am going to, was it selected as something else? State as NJ. Okay, let me just quickly check this. So here we have the state, the column name is NJ, combo box dot selected dot result, and then county. Okay, if I remove the distinct function from here, let's see what we are getting. Okay, we need to update the address column here to county. And in the search field also, we can update this to county. The significance of these two different fields is like whatever field I'm going to display as part of this. And if I have searched enabled on this combo box, the field which is, it is going to look for the value, whatever I'm entering in the search bar. Let's see if I can edit the fields from here. So in address, instead of address, I want to display county. And here also, I want the search to be enabled on this county field. If I open this again, I can see these records. So okay, I guess there was some issue with the selection. That is why I was not able to see all those records since we were in the edit mode and switching in between like selection of multiple and non-multiple property. That is why it was referring to some wrong value. But if I have selected NJ now here, I can see different states or counties that are part of this. if I'm going to do a distinct function now, and I want distinct count. Okay, so we need to update the field. So as we have used this result distinct function, so let's see. So yeah, now I can see all the counties that are related to this NJ state. Now let's go to the third level and see if I have selected a county as something and I want to see different cities related to it. So if I have selected, let's say, Gloucester, then I should be able to see all the cities that comes under this. So that is like the third level of my combo boxes. So let's say I have selected this here. And we go ahead and create a third combo box, which would be like third level of this implementation. I can apply a filter query. So filter, then my contacts Excel table. Then I can, so first I can look for if the state is equal to, combo box one dot selected. Result and the county is equals to combo box two dot selected dot result. So now if I look at the expression again, so the logic goes like, I want to see all the records where state is equals to what I have selected in the first level and the county is equals to what I have selected in the second level, and I want to see all the distinct cities. So if I go here, I select distinct and now I want city. So I select that. Let's check if we have all the right fields in place. Yep, results, and the search field is also set to result. If I open this, now I can see all the cities that comes under this NJ state and Bergen County. So that is how, like, this is an example of, you know, state, county and city, but the same can be configured on multiple levels based on the data source you're using, or I mean, based on the scenario mostly. So let's say if I have a company where I have multiple departments as running as part of that company, and in departments I have again multiple sections. So I can, if I want to see the details of a specific section, I can, you know, configure a similar implementation and select all those hierarchical, you can say, values, and I can drill into data more appropriately. So something like, if I only want to see the details of a specific city, then I can create all these details if I want it in a hierarchical way, or else I can simply create a single, a single combo box and return all the results that comes under a specific city. So now I can select a specific city from here. Now this is for like a single selection. In a case like I want to see the details inside multiple, if I have selected multiple state, or if I have selected multiple counties and cities. So let's copy and paste these controls, and we'll, you know, update the formulas so that it works for multiple selections as well. So first I have selected these, and let's enable the multiple selection feature here. I can select this, and instead of for state, the formula would be same. Like, I only want to get the distinct states, so I'm good with that one. But here in the second, the second level, I need to change the formula, because currently it says like the state is equals to selected dot result. The keyword is like selected. So if I have selected like 10 states here, if I have written selected, it's only going to look at the 10th one or the last one I have selected. So in case I want to refer it to multiple values selected, I can use this as selected items. it would give me an error like incompatible type, because this part of the expression, it's going to return a single column table, like whatever I have selected from this combo box, and I am getting all the results. So in such a case, I can use in operator, which is like it will filter the records and it will look for state. And if state exists in any of the selected items, then it is going to filter that. So let's say if I have selected LA and NJ now. So I can see that the list is now extended and I have, the counties related to LA as well now. So that is how like I can, configure multiple levels and based on multiple selections. And similarly for this one, if I want to, let's say, see the cities which are specific to, in these regions, then I can select this as state in selected items. So since we have multiple selections enabled, and same for county in selected items dot result. So if I have like selected this now, I can see a different field. So here, if I have selected a single selection for NJ and Bergen, then I can only see like six cities. But if I have also selected like Jefferson, drop down, I can see one city added in the list. So it is like based on both these conditions, based on the first and the second hierarchy of results, I can configure it based on my requirement. So if I want to configure it for a single selection, then I can go the way for like equal to. But in a case where we have like an option to select multiple records and then filter based on those, we can go ahead with the in operator. So that is something like how you can configure different scenarios in this and configure multiple hierarchical controls. So this is about like cascading drop downs. Now let's move this to the first half of the screen and let's create a editable gallery now. So here, let me create a blank vertical gallery. Okay. And I have like, I want to refer this to my SharePoint list. So that would be like students. So since I do not have any control in here just yet, so I'm not seeing any details, but I can select the gallery item and I can insert a few things like, let's say label, and I want to show this as a static value, title of the student. Okay, so this is like I have like three items in the list, so it is replicated three times on the screen. Now I can add a text input control in the gallery itself, and on the default property I can refer this to as this item dot the name, the title of the student I have in the SharePoint list. So that refers to like the title column. So we can reference it here directly. So we are creating this gallery for the purpose where let's say a teacher or some director is coming in and they want to update the details of these students. They can do that directly from the gallery itself, and they'll be able to perform a bulk update. So this is about the title. What else do we have? Their class, their address, and their section. So let's add all those. So I'm just going to copy paste this control, and let's say I name this as class. Okay, and if I again copy paste this student thing, I can update the property from title to class now. So I want to see the class this time, so I can see all these details. The next, let me copy all these things together. And I can select, I'll show here the class, class address, and here I can select their section. So I'll rename this as address, and I can extend this a little bit. address. I'll search for the field, and that's how we can show the address here. Now for section, this is a choice type field. The above the first three fields are like the single line of text, but section is a choice type field. So if I'll go back here and I see, so if I go to edit, I can see that there are like four choices for a specific field as section. So here I want the users to, you know, give a control like a drop down or something. So I can come here and input a combo box control. Let's resize this to a little smaller. Okay, so now in the items, we need to pass the values that match the format of a choice column. So I can use the choices function, choices, and the data source I want to refer it to. So students, and then dot, and what is the field? So we have section field here. Now, if I'm going to, you know, select this thing, I can see all the four values that exist in my SharePoint list, and I can select those. Okay, now this is like I have shown all the fields here, and I don't want the person to edit the name of the student. So what I can do is either I can, you know, write it instead of using a text input, I could have used a label, or if I want the UI to be, you know, uniform across this gallery, I can select this control. I can set the disable mode of this control to disabled. So now if I play this app, no one is going to edit it. I can only edit these three fields. And here in the sections property, we want to, you know, default it to the value we are returning from the students list. So I'll go to the default selected items, and I can write this item dot section. So now I can see like it has auto selected this ABC value. The reason, like, since this is a choice type field, this is directly recognizing this item dot section on a combo box, because I have passed choices function, you know, query here in the items property. If I have used a filter, then I need to do a, you know, like a lookup so that the format remains the same. What choices function returns is like, it returns two columns, ID and value, while if we are using filter, it returns all the columns. So that is why the format needs to be same, and we can, you know, select it from multiple options available here, and we can default it to what I have selected in the SharePoint list for a specific student. So ABA, I can verify it on the app, and I am seeing the details all well. Now let's see how we can, you know, perform a bulk update. So if I'm making any changes to either the class or address or section, there is no need to, you know, click individual buttons and save this data. Let's see how we can configure a single button outside this gallery to patch all these details to my SharePoint list back, and how we can, you know, configure that. So for that, we can use a for all function. What a for all function does is it iterates over, you know, any array or list type item I provide. And based on that, I am going to look for a specific ID and then update these values. So let's see how we can do this. Before that, let's create a button and see how is the schema wise everything is coming. So I'm going to create a collection. I mean, this is usually how I, you know, if I want to see some data that is going on while I'm developing the application, I usually create some temporary buttons and, you know, collect all the data in a collection or something so that I can view it easily and, you know, write my expressions appropriately. So let's say I name this as collection 2, and I want to see what all I have in the gallery control. So gallery 3 dot all items. So when I click this button, it is going to reference all the, so there will be two things basically. First is like whatever columns I have in the students list here, so they all will be stored in the collection. And second, if the values of each of these individual controls I have added inside this gallery. So if I go in and select, you know, this button. So if I go back to collections now, I can see that I have the three records which I have in the gallery. And apart from like the available attributes in the SharePoint list data source. I can see this label one underscore one. So this is like whatever I have on configured on these controls individually. So if I, you know, drill into any of these, you know, controls, so I can see the live is off, the text shows as title of student, and the tooltip is this, and I can see all those details. So if I have, let's say, changed this to B, okay, let's, so it, I was able to select multiple because this is enabled, but let's see, I have disabled it and I have selected C now. So if I go back to collections, let's refresh the collection once. So for the first record, if I go to section, I can see it is A, but I just changed it to C, and that I should be able to retrieve from the, okay, I'm referring to the wrong collection, sorry. So here I come back and text input 3, ours was a combo box, so let's search for that item. Okay, so combo box 4, if I go to the first item, I can see that it has now selected. Okay, there are so many properties. Let me just quickly search it. So it has like all the properties that are corresponding to each of the gallery item, and I can see this selected. And okay, so maybe it's not selected items. I think the collection was not refreshed. Let's do that again. Student.section, and if I go back to the collection 2, and I go back to combo box 4, selected items. Okay, for some reason it is not showing here. Let's see how we can fetch it in the formula so that the, you know, the process is easier. So for now I'm going to iterate it over all the gallery items, gallery3.allItems. Now what I want to do is I want to patch the changes you know, configured on this to the SharePoint list. So let's say I have selected students, and I want, you know, all those students to be, I'll match this based on the ID. So ID equals, now if I'll go back to the collections here, the name of column is same, I guess. So here, yeah, it's ID as same. So if we pass both the values as ID equals to ID, it is not going to recognize it properly and it will fail. So if I write something like lookup, then if we are using lookup to identify this record, so lookup students and where ID equals to ID, and this is like the values we want to pass as part of this for all query. So if I'm going to write it like ID equals to ID, it's not going to give me an error, but it's at the same point, it's not going to save any data. To overcome this, what I can do is I can rename the ID column in my gallery control. So rename columns, items, ID, ID one. So I have like renamed this column ID to ID one. And when I'm going to, you know, fetch this in the corresponding query, I can select ID one now. So that the names here is like different, and I can, you know, uniquely identify whichever record I am referring to. Now I can select individual fields like we have like disabled the title here, so we are not going to update it. The other fields are like class. So I am going to select class here, and the value that I need to pass is for this specific text input. So I can copy the name of control here. I can paste it in the formula and refer to the property, like, because since I want to, you know, extract the text out of this control, I can write like, I want to save the class as whatever we have in the text input 2_1. And same for the address field. So if I have selected this address, and I guess the name of the control is 2_2. Okay, so let's copy that. And if I come back to my formula again, I can refer the address as this dot text, and then section. So since we have like already passed the choices function in here, the format is like similar to what we need to use while patching the results. But if we have used something like filter or let's say a search query, then we may need to, you know, update this expression to, I mean, let's first see this combo box one, and I'll show you like how you can configure it for multiple cases. Dot selected. So here, if I look at the formula once again, I am going to iterate over all the gallery items, and I have renamed the ID column to ID1 so that it is recognized while we are uniquely identifying the record. Now I'm going to do a bulk patch on the students list where I am identifying the record, and I am passing the class value as what I have in the text input 2_1 and the address in the other control, and the section is what I have selected in the combo box. Let's play this and see this in action. So let's say I change this class to 3 now, and this one to, let's say, 4. I change the section to 3 and append some text to this. Okay, so we have configured the formula on this button. I can select it. It is going to make some calls. So now I can see that the process is like completed. I can go to my list again, and if I refresh this, so now I can see that the class is updated as 3, 4, whatever I have updated on the app. Similarly, ABC was appended to the text I have in the address, and same for the sections like CC and A. Now, if I go back to the app, I can perform multiple operations at the same time and, you know, save it. This is just for 3 fields, but we can do that same for based on our data sources, basically. So this is like I have written a query that is outside the gallery, and I can update all the changes I have made by hitting just a single button. In a case where this is like different from choices function, we need to write the expression something like we again need to look up, and this time we are going to look up into the choices, because choices is a function which returns the specific format for a choice type field or a lookup field. So I'll write students here dot section, and I want, so if I go value equals to combo box 4 dot selected dot value, and if I close this, I'm closing the lookup, and we want to fetch the value out of this. So this is like returning the value in the form of a specific format. So I have used a lookup function which is going to look for this specific value, let's say C. So it is going to look for that value and return this response in a required format. So that is how like we can configure it. If I'm not using the choices function, we can do that on the basis of value. Okay, so that is like one thing. Apart from that, if you have a scenario where you don't want to save all the details, so let's say I have just made changes to second and third record, and I don't want the first record to be updated, what I can do is I can either, you know, add a label here and hide it. So it is like tracking all the changes. If so, let's see. I'm going to add just one label because we are running out of time. So we can track this something like if this item dot we are going to track that for the class equals text input to dot text. Okay, 2_1.text. Then we can write not changed and changed. So this is like I have just added a test label here, and we can apply the same changes while we are, you know, applying this for all loop. Instead of directly patching, we can add a condition using the if expression. So let's say if I, you know, come here and update this to 2. Now I can see that this is changed. So based on applying such a condition, I can, you know, restrict the for all loop to only certain items and not update everything. So that is how it is tracking for one field, but we can do the same for other fields as well, like class, address, and section. So any questions, guys? I think that was all from my side today. So if you have any questions, please feel free to ask.
I think there's just one word.
One, and that's wow. Everyone's really, really impressed with that session. So much covered in 1 hour. So thank you so much, Ritika, for covering so much. If there's any session today that's giving people a way to get started with Canvas apps, really, this is one of the best sessions that really does cover everything, the details, really. So thank you again. Anthony Escobedo asks a question to yourself, Ritika. He asks, what is your favorite database to work with?
Mine is CDS.
Ah, nice.
So the reason behind that is like I can, you know, integrate it with anything, almost everything. So I have recently started working on portals, and using CDS as a data source there is like a gem. So that's my favorite data source.
And that's an excellent segue for moving on to the CDS session. So the following sessions for the rest, the remainder of the day are CDS focused. What you've seen this morning have all been Canvas app focused. So thank you once again. Now, I know, Ritika, you are back to back with sessions. And mm-hmm. I know you need a little bit of a rest, don't you, Ritika? So do you want to, how about some options here, Ritika? Mm-hmm. I mean, do you either want 5 minute break whilst we explain the rest of the agenda for the day? Or do you want maybe, would you like Yash to maybe do his session and then you do yours just so you can get a break? What would you prefer?
I mean, I'm good with...